want to put it in the following way. The question asked is the following. If from experience the prices of all commodities, that is an empirical fact, if you wish, find a set of conditions that will make these prices appear to be necessary. This means given the unknowns, find the equations. But once you've found the equations, right, then you have the theory, and then you can reverse the thing, as he points out here, and indeed, as we see, that is what he did. Now, in November 1927, he formulated the document Principio, in which he pointed out what he was going to do. He was trying to re-establish, indeed, an approach called the classical approach, the classical theories of value, but it was, so to speak, an attempt to provide, as he called it, a frame, a machine, capable of incorporating the basic ideas of all these authors mentioned here, Betty, Cantillon, the physicists, Smith, Powell, and Marx. It was an attempt, really, to bring together the messages of these authors and overcome, so to speak, their differences in terms of finding out what is common to them and what is the difference with later theories. So there was the idea of counterposing, on the one hand, a classic approach to value distribution and later developments, particularly Marxism. Now, as regards the classical approach, Sartre quickly discerned important elements, which I've just mentioned here very briefly. A production consists essentially in a transformation of matter and energy into other forms of matter and energy, paraphrasing James Mill. Production involves destruction. Now this led him to a concept of physically clear cost, as he called it, which was meant to be directly counterposed to the Marshallian concept of real cost, which however was not real at all, it was a subjectivist, this is really the abstinence weighting. So, this is a crucial element, as we can see later on in the development of Sartre's idea about the basis of the theory of value distribution. He also pointed out that production is essentially a circular flow. There is no such thing as the production of commodities exclusively by unassisted labor, to use Ricard's term. There is no such thing as the Austrian one-way avenue from original factors of production ending up in commodities. It is a circular flow of production that is of great importance. And production in modern society is typically great social surplus. And the question that is, I skip this because there's not enough time, volunteer positions, cost minimizing systems. The question then is, what is the role of the scramble for the surplus and relative prices? This will be pointed out in a minute. Now, as regards the general orientation of Sartre's approach, he was very fascinated by William Petty, and there is one famous saying by Petty, which basically revolves around that objectivist, realist orientation, namely expressing himself only in terms of number, weight, or measure. And that is a theme in Sartre's papers, which is indeed stated throughout his analysis. Try to focus on things you can actually observe, measure, and principle at any rate, and deal with without dealing with opinions, appetites, and passions that change all the time. You could say it's counterposing, if you wish, a classical objectivist approach and a later neoclassical approach, which of course Petty at the time didn't know, couldn't know. Now, as regards the circular flow, clearly enough, I mean, he found it in Petty, he also found it in Quinet, and he identified in some places his own analysis, indeed in Tableau Economique. He thought that was the basis, so to speak, of the classical theory, and a modern version of the Tableau Economique had to be established. He came across many, and actually was looking for statements in which this physical real cost approach was reflected in the writings of earlier authors, and one particularly significant passage is the one by James Mill, who pointed out that the agents of production are the commodities themselves. They are the food of the laborer. Without food, I mean, birds do not perform the task. They are the tools and the machinery with which the worker works and the raw materials which he works upon. So he found that in the earlier authors, you indeed had the idea that costs were essentially physical real costs. They consisted in real wages and which could be given as inventory of commodities, etc., etc. As regards core models, it was also clear, to some from a fairly early time, I would say, that what Ricardo was trying to establish was a theory which eventually allowed one to understand income distribution, and that is essentially the inverse relationship between the rate of profits in the competitive conditions and the real wage rate, or the share of wages in income, without having reference to prices. And so this is another concern of that which eventually, of course, led to some commodity which you can see at a glance without reference to prices what is going on. Now, Safar understood that economic theory, of course, needs analytic instruments to be properly developed, but there was the problem on the one hand that you might have a very rich idea about the right concepts, but you might lack the tools to bring those concepts to fruition. And this was one of the arguments he put forward with regard to the classical economists and why it was possible that despite the richness of their concepts, the classical economists eventually were overcome and their doctrine gave way to what he considered to be much less convincing, namely marginalism. And it had a lot to do with the discrepancy between concepts on the one hand and tools on the other hand. But there's also the problem, of course, as Lasser pointed out on various occasions, that you might be overcome by the tools we developed. And one of his arguments was that neoclassical authors, very often, I mean, after having studied the tools, the mathematics and all that, eventually they become the slaves of those tools and cannot any longer think about economic problems in a proper way. Now, I'm not going into a detailed discussion of time of Slater's early criticism of the labor theory of value. Let me just refer you to a paper Nils Salvadori and I published in the Festschrift in honor of Ian Steedman. There we point out the various aspects of the problem at hand. It has not only to do with solving equations, it has to do with the meaning and the application of value labor reasoning in different at different stages of society. I am also not going into discussion of Safa as regards his critique of Smith, etc. Let me just point out that he counterposed at an early time what he called the physical real cost approach and the Ricardo Marxian theory of labor costs, in that the former does and the latter does not include in them the natural resources that are used up in the course of production, such as coal and iron, etc. This is fundamental because it does away with human energy in such metaphysical things. It is interesting to note that up until even the proof stage of his book, Slater kept there a passage in one of the paragraphs dealing with exhaustive resources. So you see this engagement in thinking in physically real terms, in using up resources, is there. Now, it turned out that Slater's approach, commodities were produced by means of commodities, of course, immediately showed you that all values that emerge can be seen eventually as due to labor, sure, or to wheat, or to any other thing that enters in the production of every one of them. I mean, this is, you could say, a quick answer to the famous question of what is the common third. If two commodities exchange for one another, what is the common third of them? What is the common substance that makes that equality of certain quantities of the two commodities to be equal to one another? And the argument is that there are many common